Hello and welcome to Harry Ainlay One Acts 2021. My name is Owen Connolly, and over the past few months, we've been working extremely hard to bring this show to life. We've encountered many new obstacles and challenges over the past year, such as having to act with masks on, lighting our stage so we can be picked up by the camera, and to top it all off, getting shut down and having to rehearse over Google Meets. I can tell you from experience that rehearsing online isn't the most fun thing to do in the world. We are extremely excited to bring you this show tonight, but before we do, I would like to add that this show does contain harsh language and mature themes. These include PTSD, sexual assault, and trauma. If any of these upset you, please do not feel embarrassed or ashamed for turning off your device. The Canadian Mental Health Organization website is available 24/7 for consulting, and dialing 211 will put you through to the Mental Health Helpline. SACE, the Sexual Abuse Center of Edmonton, is always available for anyone who needs to access them. They offer many different types of support for those who have experienced sexual assault. The Mental Health Hotline is always available for calling, as is the Kids Help Phone. There is always help available for anyone who ever needs it. Also, just a little side note, please turn your settings to 1080p so that the video quality isn't as blurry, and if your brightness is down on your device, please turn it up so we, the actors, can be seen quite a bit better. Anyways, without further ado, here is a little one.
Here comes the bride, all dressed in white. Here they are, standing at the airport. She's got a suitcase with Hello Kitty on it, held together with duct tape. She's smiling and bowing, and he's looking her up and down, and they're both a little nervous because this is it, the first day of the rest of their lives. They get in the car, and she tries out her English on him, and he tries out his Vietnamese on her. And they share a forced laugh. They get to the house, and he's probably thinking, she's just as beautiful as she was in the photographs. And she's probably thinking, what a big house. They go upstairs, and they're standing in the bedroom staring at the bed. Both of them thinking, here's where the magic doesn't happen. After all, this is the end point of her journey, this bed. This is why she's traveled across oceans, so she could become a resident of this bed. They go downstairs into the kitchen, and they each have a sandwich. Turkey on rye. She has a glass of juice from the fridge, and he has a beer from the cooler in the garage. And in the back of both of their minds is the lumpy bed with sweaty sheets on it. It's gnawing at them, the thought of this bed. Because in a few short hours, they'll both be in it. The next morning, they drive to the civil registry for their 7 a.m. appointment. There's some paperwork and a brief congratulations from the city clerk, and then this is it, the first day of the rest of their lives. And the question you're wanting to ask is, what happened in the bed? And what is that sound? It's the middle of the night, for Christ's sakes.
This weekend at a work function for the all the residents of the hospital, I talked about her. Claire. It's funny. I don't talk about her much, but she's probably why I went to med school, so I talked about her to the other surgical residents. I told the story of the dinner party with Roger and Kim Lee. It gives a quick snapshot of Claire. My sister, Claire. I'm saying Claire, but the social workers called Claire, because they didn't know her name. Claire wasn't talking when they brought her in. Found her in some boarded up condemned building. They had to call her something, so she was Claire. My mother and father died in a house fire in a military base. They moved the ashtray from the bedside table to the bed. My great aunt Rose raised me until I was around 4 years old. She was half deaf, so I didn't learn to speak properly. My first word was, "What?" And I ate a lot of SpaghettiOs and played with the dustbuster. But I was doing okay when Aunt Rose died of throat cancer and Mom and Dad adopted me. Claire's first 4 years. We were living in the old family house in Ottawa next door to Roger and Kim Lee. And Mom was teaching piano, and in the summer she'd leave the patio doors open so you could hear the piano lessons all the way down our Ave. Our very prosperous, our very liberal middle class Ave. Kim Lee would stand outside on her porch and listen to the piano. Dad would come home from his job at the civil services and he'd see Kim Lee standing there and he'd say, "It's in a language she understands." Because of course Kim Lee was a new Canadian. We were calling her Kimmy right then, but later on she went back to Kim Lee, probably because that was her name. There was a lot of curiosity about Kim Lee on our Ave because she came to Canada to marry Roger, and Kim Lee was very pretty, and Roger was in the tech industries. They lived in the house next door that already seemed haunted before anything happened in it. I don't know if Mom saw Kim Lee standing there or what, but Mom started to give Kim Lee piano lessons, and as it turned out, Kim Lee was a natural. Mom said she probably would have been a child prodigy if she'd learned as a child, if she'd had a piano in Vietnam. So, Mom invited Roger and Kim Lee for dinner to make friends with them as a couple. And that's when the thing happened with my sister Claire. Claire had been in the family for around 2 months by then. I was only 6 years old and Claire was four. I was too young to understand what was happening, but when I went through puberty, I saw how it was probably, out of all the things Claire did, it. Roger and Kim Lee were sitting on the couch and they were a little nervous because this was their first dinner party. There was a lot of curiosity about them on our app. Unkind curiosity, so I think they wanted to make friends pretty badly. So they were a little nervous. The wine was starting to work on their nerves. And Roger was cracking a few jokes. He told this cute, dumb story about his nickname for Kim Lee. And all the adults were laughing. And that's when Claire crawled into his lap. And she undid his pants. I think it seemed like she was being friendly. You know, crawled right into his lap. Like, "Oh, cute. She likes Roger." Then we heard the zip sound. And Claire started to put her hands, and Roger got a sick look on his face, like he didn't know what to do, like this can't be happening, like why is this nice family moment being ruined by the worst possible. It was so bad that Claire did that they couldn't go on with the dinner party. So Roger and Kim Lee left. What do you do after that? Serve chicken? It's stupid. I still wonder this because of what I know about what I went through with Claire, but I do still wonder what would have happened if Mom hadn't pulled Claire off of Roger. What would she have done? Would she have done it?
A year's gone by. They're a year into marriage now, and the two of them are homemaking. It's all Home Depot and IKEA, and how the fuck do you put this together? And ooh, new wallpaper on the walls, and ooh, new wall-to-wall carpeting on the floors, and a new mattress that isn't so lumpy, and new sheets that aren't so sweaty. There's something else in the house, a sort of contentment? He's slimmed down eating pho soup, and she's filled out eating maple syrup, sockeye salmon, and grade A Alberta beef. She's finally starting to get used to Ottawa, used to the sound of millions of people all being very quiet together. Shh, we're in Ottawa. Shh. course, the neighbors think that the marriage is not, that it can't be. That when she turns over the question in the dark hours of the night, if she really loves him, she probably thinks something like, "It was very kind of him to buy me that piano." The truth is, it does seem very unlikely that she could ever fall in love with a puffy Canadian with an IT gut who has the nervous habit of pulling at the crotch of his pants. The most likely thing is, she's quite incapable of loving him. That smile, that flickering in her eyes that she gets when she looks across a garage sale or a dinner party at him. It's benign disinterest, a mild sort of contempt, sort of blank. But then again, it is so difficult to know what that smile of hers means.
Claire would seem normal for a while. Things would be going along normally. And then Claire would get caught molesting a boy with mild intellectual disorder in her special class at school. Because, of course, the boy couldn't consent because of the mild intellectual disorder. And I'd hear Mom crying behind closed doors, and Dad talking to her in a voice I got familiar with. Dad's, "Claire did something horrifying," voice. And then we'd rush Claire back to the psychiatrist offices with the smooth wooden toys and anatomically correct plush dolls. And we'd all sit in the psychiatrist offices together, and Mom and Dad would say, "I love you, Claire. I love you, Claire. I love you." Because, of course, they thought love was the answer. So they said, "I love you." And so would I. "Aaron, tell your sister you love her." "I love you, Claire." Claire would get a blank look in her face. She was a monster. I don't want to kill the suspense for you, but she was a monster. It was the trauma. Between the dinner party with Roger and Kim Lee, which got talked about, and all the setting things on fire and abnormal violent behavior at our elementary school, the whole neighborhood watched Claire. They watched her terrorize us. Claire stole an axe out of a child's toolbox Mom and Dad gave me for my birthday and chopped a bunch of keys out of Mom's piano. Or she'd find one of the doors to our neighbor's houses unlocked, and they'd come home and find her standing in their bedroom like a zombie. Or she took to peeing in the corner of her room. Or, okay, we got two fish, and one of them died, and Mom said we have to flush that one. And Claire flushed the live one down the toilet.
No, I didn't.
Flushed the live fish.
No, I didn't.
You did, Claire. You flushed the live one.
I didn't. It was dead. They were both floating at the top of the water with slime trailing off of them.
Both fish?
Yeah.
Both fish died.
Yeah.
Then why'd you only flush one fish? Why is there a dead one still floating in there?
I like that one.
It's dead.
I like it anyway.
You can't like it. It's dead.
I'd like you if you were dead.
Claire, have you seen any of my Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles?
No.
Because one of them's gone.
Check under your dresser.
I have checked under my dresser. I've checked everywhere. I've checked my knapsack and the couches, and I've checked everywhere.
Not everywhere. Well, it's somewhere.
Yeah. Mom said we're not getting any more fish. She said we're going to take a break from fish for a while.
We still have the dead one.
Gross.
Gross.
You're peeing in your room again, huh?
Yeah.
Great.
Yeah.
Is there pee on your pants now?
Yeah.
Why?
I stepped in it.
You want me to go get Mom?
Hmm.
Me?
Yep.
Come here then. Yeah?
I said yeah.
Look, don't go out like this, okay? Don't go to school like this. You don't need the kids at school smelling your pee. Leg. Lift your leg. Leg.
I just remembered where your Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle is.
It was, yeah. It was in, up, Claire. I asked the ER resident who extracted it if I could have it back, and he told me it was in hazardous bio waste. I wasn't supposed to, but I asked Claire. Hey, buddy, how did Raphael get up there?
I don't know. I don't know!
It's okay. The psychiatrists who worked with Claire were very specific about what we could say to her, what we could ask her, how to touch her, and how not to answer her when she said things like,
I want to scratch you. I want to scratch your eyes out.
Want to do some finger painting?
Yeah.
Okay, fun. You go get the finger paints, okay? And I'll go get some paper.
Okay.
Mom! Mom and Dad relied on me to be good with Claire. To be the good one who made the honor roll, was captain of a hockey team, learned to play piano. Claire was the traumatized one with the awful, chilling, horrifying. And Mom would say, thank God, Aaron is so well adjusted so we can focus on Claire. For Mom and Dad's sake, I tried. I tried with Claire. Even when I was 12, Claire stuck me with a knife. Hey, buddy. You okay? Where's Mom?
She's teaching Kimmy.
Claire, is that pudding on your pants? Because those are my puddings for hockey. Is that blood?
No.
Yes, it is.
Oh.
What did you do?
Oh, it was the knife.
What? Why did you have a knife?
I stuck it in myself.
Where did you stick it? Is it still in there?
No.
Where is it? Dad!
It didn't hurt.
Dad, get up here! Dad! Dad!
See? It doesn't hurt. You okay?
Yeah, I'm okay, buddy. Can you go get Mom and tell her there's a knife in me? Can you do that for me, buddy?
Yeah.
Can you walk?
Yeah.
Okay, it's gonna be okay. It's gonna be okay.
Yeah?
Just go get Mom.
I'm sorry, though.
It's okay, just go get Mom. Get Mom!
Mom!
I have a lot of fond childhood memories of the whole family together in the ER. Mom waited with me while the doctor stitched me up and told me how proud she and Dad were of me for handling getting stabbed so well and talking Claire through it. On the drive home from the hospital, Mom said, some people don't know the difference between loving someone and hurting them. For some people, loving and hurting can be the same thing. Dad said, for Claire. When Claire came home from the psych, Mom and Dad put a lock on the knife drawer so she couldn't stab us. Like I said, she was a monster.
No, I'm not. I'm not a monster.
It's okay.
I'm not.
It's okay. That kid is not nice. Mom said that the family's going to have to move away because they don't fit the neighborhood. And he wasn't saying that you are a monster. He was saying if you were a monster and you were going to kill someone, who would it be? You don't know the answer to that. Do you? Me? You'd kill me?
Not you.
Why not?
You're my brother and I love you.
Mom!
Why?
Mom, get up here, Mom!
Why?
You said I love you?
Yeah, you're my brother.
Yeah. Right around when I was turning 14, Claire was 12, the psychiatrist called us all in as a family for a meeting. They told us Claire was improving. Big strides, one of them said. We're nearing a breakthrough. By that point, Mom was crying into the couch, and Dad was laughing and saying, it's good news, honey, it's good news. I thought, for a second. The upshot was, Claire's psychiatrist felt we were nearing a critical phase. Claire might start remembering her trauma, which meant we were supposed to support her therapy by spending as much time as possible in the next few months with her as a family unit. Then all the adults looked at me and...
How come you're at hockey?
And Dad said, what do you think, Aaron? Do you think you could do that for us, buddy? It'd be a big help.
Aaron? Hey, Aaron, how come you're at hockey?
We wouldn't ask if it wasn't important.
Was it canceled?
What?
Hockey's canceled?
Oh, yeah.
Why?
I wasn't that good at it anymore, so.
You were good at it?
Yeah, but, hey, Mom said she might let me get a cat or a dog. Probably a cat, but She hasn't said no to a dog yet.
You bored?
Yep.
Maybe you should go to hockey.
Shut up, player.
You're not allowed to say shut up, and why aren't you at hockey?
Claire?
What?
Claire.
What?
Is that your name?
What?
Is it your name?
That's what you call me?
Mom said your name might be something that you can't remember. So maybe one day something will jog your memory and you'll be like, hey, stop calling me Claire, fuckers.
Fuckers.
Is Claire your name? So no?
Yes.
So no.
You're not supposed to ask me that.
No.
You're being mean.
Yeah.
Why?
I'm sorry. I'm sorry, buddy. What are you doing there? Are you hugging me?
Yeah.
The flickers of normalcy were, she was my, I did think of her as my sister.
Years and years have gone by, and the two of them, him and her, are still together, still married, still living in the same ratty old house on the same prosperous block that's been fixed up just enough so that the neighbors don't give them any dirty looks at garage sales. She's playing a prelude on the piano, and he's out on the porch with his chair tilted back and a beer from the cooler in the garage in his hands. So they're still together, him and her. So what's the glue here? Maybe it's the jokes. There is one joke, and it's their own private, hilarious, terrible joke that dates all the way back to the first days of their marriage. She only brought one thing with her from Vietnam, a Hello Kitty suitcase held together with duct tape. And now it's in the basement covered in dust. And he says to her, "Hello, Kitty." He gets home from his IT job and unlocks the front door and yells up the stairs, "Hello, Kitty. Hello, Kitty." In certain moods, it's, "Hello, Kitty." And in certain moods, it's, "Kitty, please answer the phone when I call you in the middle of the day. I don't care if you're in the middle of a fugue or not, or Kitty, where are my pants? Did you stir fry them? Or Kitty, not funny, untie me." And his way of being aggravated with her, his way of teasing her, only adds to their sense of normalcy, their contentment. They, yes, seem content. That little flicker more than content, that is love. From time to time, she does grab the old pair of the rusted kitchen scissors from the drawer in the kitchen and hides them in the darkest corner of the garage with that flicker of something in her eye. But that's not happening right now. Right now, the grass is blowing and the streetlights are humming, and the final note of the prelude hangs in the air. And he calls to her, "Kitty! I'm out on the porch. Come drink your juice out here with me." And you hear the fridge door open and close as she gets out the juice. And you thought that her heart was packed with ice. But now she's standing on the porch, leaning over her husband with that flicker of something in her eye. And you'd think it's unlikely, but it looks like love. And if it's not love, it sure looks like it.
Mom let me get a cat as a thank you for spending so much family unit time with Claire. Mom came with me to the shelter and we picked it out together. It was a little thing with his eyes shut, snuffling around the bottom of the box. I nursed him with a... Claire! with an eyedropper that had warm milk in it. And I'd given him some dumb name, but mostly I called him Little One.
Ugh.
What?
Little One? You're like a girl.
You're a girl?
I don't know if I like cats.
Why not?
Mm.
Here, you want to hold him?
No. It's a bad little thing, isn't it?
No.
The owner didn't want it?
He didn't even drown him. He just left him in the gutter.
You drowned them?
No! No, Claire, you don't drown them. Remember, we got a cat because your behavior was stabilizing.
Yeah, I know, fart face. I know my behavior is stabilizing because everyone keeps bringing it up all the time.
And this is my cat, okay? Like, my things. You don't touch my things. You don't touch my cat unless I'm here with you.
I don't want to touch your pet.
Yeah, you do.
No!
Here. Hold him.
No, no, no!
What's up, Claire?
Mmm!
Hey there, little one. Aw, it's okay, buddy. It's okay.
Hey, little one!
Claire! Hey there, little one. Aw, it's okay, buddy. Aw, it's okay. Hey there, little one. Hey there, buddy. What if I record it for you and you can practice it? What about that? Okay. Hey there, little one.
Hey there, little one.
Yeah. Hey there, little one.
Hey there, little one.
Yeah. Yeah. I know Mom and Dad felt like the long fight for Claire was finally being won. Hey there, little one.
Hey there, little one.
And then my cat went missing. I put up missing cat posters all over the neighborhood and went up and down our ave yelling, okay, I named the cat Fish because of the pet fish Claire flushed down the toilet. And I went up and down our ave yelling, Fish! Fish! Come here, Fish! Fish! Weeks went by and no cat.
Fartface, I'm returning your thing, okay? Fartface? You're gloomy. You feel bad.
No.
You feel downcast.
Are you working on emotional vocabulary or something in therapy, Claire?
Yeah. So why do you feel...
Because of my cat!
Are you going to replace
it? I don't know, just...
Just what?
Fuck off.
Swear.
Claire?
Swear.
I said your name, it's not a swear.
Your tone was a swear.
Shut up.
Swear. So you feel sad.
I don't... I feel sad.
If you'd replaced me, I'd feel sad. It's probably dead.
Yeah.
When cats die, they crawl into the porch. If a car hits them and they're wounded, they crawl into the porch to lick their wounds. And if their wounds are bad, they crawl into the porch to die.
We don't have a porch?
Yeah.
What?
What? We don't have a porch. Roger and Kim Lee have a porch.
Claire! I ran next door and I got on my hands and knees in the dirt and I crawled under the porch. I got about halfway under and then I saw a lump with little bits of fur sticking off of it. Then I crawled back out and I punched Claire in the head. Mom came running out of the house and she saw Claire. Claire had a nosebleed, and she grabbed me, and she started screaming in my face, we don't hit people, we don't hit people, and I wanted to. Finally, I got it out. Claire murdered Fish. He's under the porch.
No, I didn't.
Yes, you did.
I didn't!
And Dad went and knocked on Roger and Kimley's door, and Roger and Kimley came out and stood on the porch. And we all watched Dad crawl under there, and he pulled it out. The dead cat. Mom covered my eyes and said, don't look, don't look. Mom and Dad called a family meeting.
There was a tan station wagon. It was going probably about 20 kilometers an hour, and Fish didn't know which way to run. So he crouched down, and the car smushed Fish, so I picked him up off the road, and I got out the milk dropper Aaron had used when Fish was a baby kitten, and I got out the bottle of Jack Daniels from the liquor cabinet, and I fed Fish about 3/4 of the bottle of Jack Daniels.
The cat died of alcohol poisoning. That's what Claire told Mom and Dad at the family meeting. Mom said, She was trying to save it when she killed it. I said, how did he get under the porch, Claire?
I carried it in a cardboard box and I emptied it out under Roger and Kimley's porch.
Hey, remember weeks ago when I asked you if you killed my cat and you said no?
Because I didn't.
Yes, you did.
No, I didn't. I didn't even like it enough to kill it.
What? What? That's... What?
I mean... What I mean is... That came out wrong. What I mean is I was still learning to like it. I still didn't like it very much, so I wouldn't go into your room without you and... play with it?
And then Mom and Dad told me to apologize for hitting my sister. And I said, oh, fuck you! And Dad pulled me into the hallway and he said, please, Aaron, please. Claire's been doing so well lately. She should have come and told us when your cat got hit by the car, and she didn't do that. And that was very wrong of her. But the psychiatrist said she's very close to remembering the bad things that happened to her. And then she'll be able to get the real help she needs. So, please, Aaron, please, can you just hang in there a little longer, buddy? And I said, so you're just going to let her kill my cat? And Dad said, Aaron, you knew when we got the cat that there was the possibility that it wouldn't work out for Claire. And I said, Dad, I dropped out of hockey. I go on our dumb family outings. I fucking hang out with mostly my little sister. And now my cat is dead. And then Dad gave me a pain look and he said, I hope you can find yourself to be the older brother here.
Cat.
Claire needs your help and sympathy right now, buddy, so let's just let it go.
It was just a cat.
Okay?
It's just a cat.
And Claire kept saying,
it was just a cat.
It was just a cat. For days.
It was just a cat. It was just a cat.
Mom,
it was just a cat.
Mom, come and get Claire to my room. I need a fucking, I need a break.
She's gone outside to talk to the neighbors to find out what happened at Roger and Kim Lee's house. There's police tape up and police cars parked on the lawn. I could tell you some stuff I saw. Roger and Kim Lee stuff.
Claire.
It was just a cat.
And then Mom and Dad took us camping, which was a stupid...
It was just a cat.
Stupid ploy to get me to...
It was just a cat.
Fuck off!
It was just a cat!
Claire, fuck off. Look, I'm sorry I'm swearing at you, but I have leeches on my legs, so please, just shut the fuck up, okay? Mom's going to get sold from the head office, so please, go fuck yourself, because I have leeches.
Sorry about your leeches.
Just fucking shut up. I'm gonna punch you so bad, but I can't, because we don't hit people.
Will it make you feel better if you punch
so
me?
So much better.
Then I want you to. Punch me. Do you have a crush on the girl in the red raincoat? The one you're hanging close to down on the beach?
No.
She had on a red raincoat? Because you keep hanging out with her, so it seems like you have a crush on her. Like a whole mixtape full of dumb love song-sized crush on her. You know, because you gave her the whole mixtape full of dumb love songs. Seems like she likes you. Do you? You still love me, though. Mom's taking a long time with the salt.
Mom and Dad planned a whole pile of fun activities for us on this camping trip, like hiking through a swamp full of leeches. The moment they turned their back, I'd sneak off. Get away for a few hours and go and find this girl. This normal, this pretty girl. Then I'd come back to our tent and sneak back into our tent.
Where were you? Where were you, Aaron? I didn't tell Mom and Dad you were gone. I think they guessed you're with that girl. I told Mom you were in the bathrooms, but I think she guessed you were with the girl. The tent's all wet. It's letting water in. Aaron! Oh. You had alcohol? With the girl? She gave you alcohol? What did she give you?
Beer with wine in it.
Please talk.
I just did.
You still love me.
I love you is something I say to you because Mom and Dad tell me I have to. Now just shut up and go to sleep.
That's not true.
Yes, it is.
I'm sorry, Kay. I'm sorry about the cat. I'm saying sorry, okay?
You can't just say you're sorry, Claire, because you're not sorry. And you know how I know you're not sorry? Because you're lying about killing my cat. And I can't tell Mom and Dad you're lying because I would fuck them for life. And I can't forgive you for killing my cat because you fucking killed it.
I'm not lying.
You... Okay.
For years, I've been watching you and trying to keep you from wrecking my stuff, and I know when you're lying. I can tell. You're lying about my cat, like you're lying about lots of things. Like Claire's not your real name. It's just something you let us call you.
Do you still love me?
No.
It was just a cat.
You're just some girl I hate.
That's not true, though.
Hey, what's your name? Claire? Come on, tell me.
I don't remember.
Hey, what's your name?
Should I tell you, then you'll forget about the cat?
You killed it? Why?
They're bad little things. Aaron, all I did was I fed it a lot of alcohol. It got hit by a car and the alcohol made it die of alcohol. That's all. I gave it alcohol to make it not be crying, and then I couldn't stop giving it alcohol. I got stuck on giving alcohol and I don't know why.
You wrecked everything.
I'm sorry, Kay. I'm sorry they took my side, but it was just a cat. It doesn't mean that Mom and Dad don't love you. They love you. It's just they don't love you as much as they love me. Please, I'm telling you. Please,
Get
I'm telling
off.
My name,
Get
Aaron.
Off.
Come here, I'm telling you.
What are you doing?
Aaron, please, just let
what
me tell
you. So, yeah, that was not good. Sorry, I don't like to think about it. I'm not gonna. That's it. That's all I'm gonna. I went to Mom and Dad's tent and I was shaking. And Mom kept saying, "What's happened? What's happened?" And I kept telling her that I didn't want to talk about it. That I couldn't talk about it. And then Mom said, she said something like, "Please, Aaron. Please, Claire is not well. Why stop doing this to her?" And I said, "Mom, are you blind? Why don't you ever ask what she's doing to me?" Mom looked like I'd hit her, and then she asked if Claire had ever touched me, and I didn't say anything. Claire had a history of, well, there was whatever happened to her when she was a toddler, but she also had a history of molesting her classmates at school, so I didn't have to say much for Mom to get what I was. I told her it was just minor stuff that Claire did. I know Mom and Dad saw it, still see it as a failure. But no one faulted them for it. No one thought they'd last as long as they did as Claire's parents. Claire ripped a chunk of Mom's hair out and yelled my name and called me a liar when they put her in the van. Yeah. She got much worse in the group homes. She was violent with the staff, so they transferred her to Ward H at the Royal Ottawa Hospital. The psych ward. She was in psych, some halfway houses for around 14 years. 2 months ago, they let her out.
When the terrible thing happens, the neighbors tell the police that they did hear something in the middle of the night. It was a dull sort of pounding. The kind of pounding that makes you twist one eyelid open and mumble to yourself, "What is that sound? It's the middle of the night, for Christ's sakes." Now there's police tape up and police cars parked out on the lawn, and of course she didn't love him. Of course they weren't happy. Of course it was a crappy marriage, because in the end, the human heart isn't as perverse as that. It isn't as unlikely as a dull, predictable organ. And the question, the old question, what happened in the bed, flickers in your brain, because it must have been bad if there's police tape up. If, say, a week back, you'd crossed the dark lawns, opened the front door to their house, and climbed at the creaky staircase, and you'd listened, you'd have heard it. Something pounding. The kind of pounding makes you go down the hallway, because now you know There's something in the bedroom pounding and pounding. Something wants to get out. So you push the door open just a crack and you see... it's him. He's tied to the bed with the rag stuffed in his mouth and the pounding. The pounding is the bed. Pounding against the floor as he strains to get the fuck out of there. So, you want to know why? Why she tied him up and left him there? Because I can tell you. I can tell you what happened in the bed. Nothing. Nothing happened. He let her try for a while, and boy, did she try. She tried until her hands cramped, until her nose bled. Then he went mad, yanked on it so hard the skin ripped. He got out the old pair of the rusted kitchen scissors as if to cut it off, and she screamed until he dropped them. Then he stopped meeting her eye or answering to his name. And hour after hour, he slumped in the bed in just a t-shirt, flicking it over and over again with his finger, flicking it raw. And I guess she couldn't take it for one more hour. I guess she couldn't watch him flick it just one more time. Because if you creep back down the stairs, you'll see her sitting at the kitchen table. Oh, so still. Only her lips are moving. She's mouthing a string of words, and if you lean in close enough, you can just make out what she's saying. She's saying, Aaron, do you know what she's saying? I love you. 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 I love you.
Trails off like that. It. That's it. That's it. The whole thing's 10 minutes of tape. Her voice, a recording of her voice, and then nothing. No writing. Nothing. Just this crappy cassette player. Do I call the police? What do I say? I say my psychopathic little sister just mailed me this creepy story of her ex-neighbors Roger and Kim Lee. I'm pretty sure she's threatening me. What do I say when they ask me why I think that? Because I just think that? Because it's happened in my nightmares? So, Kim Lee killed Roger. Roger died. He died of dehydration. The police said that Kim Lee was in the house for days, probably sat in there with Roger tied up upstairs, slowly dehydrating. And yeah, we all figured that she'd done it out of self-defense. She was a mail order bride. We figured he'd been forcing her to do some sick. Kim Lee went crazy. She'd gone crazy. By the time the police found her and Roger's corpse, she never talked coherently about what happened after that. And the city boarded up the house. Claire knows my home address, which is not good. I should turn this over to the call the police. I should call my parents, because she's saying that she's gonna kill me? Yeah. Yes. Or is she telling me her version of a nice story? Or is she saying she loved us all along, let's be friends? Or is she telling me she's gonna kill me out of love? Or some fucking other fucked up thing that I can't even... I did a bad thing. Is that what she's saying? I did a bad thing. I tried to. I went to med school because of her. I became a surgical resident because I wanted to help unwell people. And I have tried to be the good one. I've tried to... Fuck, it wasn't a lie. It just wasn't totally... But it doesn't matter because she was wrecking our lives. She was fucked up. I don't think that's because of me. She was just like that. It wasn't her fault, but she wasn't capable of love. She was fucked up. Psychopathic, fucked up. No, I don't. I'm not going to think about what I did. Get off.
I'm telling you.
Get off of me.
Come here. I'm telling you.
What are you doing?
Aaron, please just let me tell you.
Are you crazy?
Aaron.
No.
Aaron.
No. What were you gonna do? Jesus, you... No, no!
I'm trying to tell you!
Tell me what?
My name!
Tell me from there!
Please, just let me tell you in your ear!
Well, I don't want you anywhere near me, so...
It's Kitty.
You're kidding.
No.
Who called you that?
My dad.
You remember him?
Yeah.
And he said that to you?
Yeah, it's my name. Roger said it to Kim Lee when I was watching them. I went to their house to watch them, and he said it to her, and I remembered. I remembered my dad saying it.
Your dad said Kitty to you?
Yeah.
Like, here, Kitty, Kitty, like that?
Yeah.
And then what did he do?
I'm a bad little thing.
No, no, you're not. It's okay.
It's okay. It's okay, but it's okay. It's okay. It's okay. It's okay. It's okay because Mom still loves me and Dad still loves me.
I need to, I need to go to Mom and Dad's tent for a little to, I need to tell them I'm back from hanging out down at the beach. I don't smell like beer, do I? Okay. I'm just gonna tell them I'm back, and that's it, okay? So you stay here and go back to sleep, okay? Go back to sleep.
Okay, but I want to tell them my name, not you, okay?
Oh, I won't tell Mom anything. I won't say anything.
Don't say anything.
I won't. I'm sorry. I just need to get out of this tent for a little. I need some air.
Aaron, I love you.
Thank you so much for watching, little one. Please wait. We are switching over to Sure Thing in about 15 minutes. Sure Thing will be on live in about 15 minutes. Thank you.